please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
A very good morning. Welcome to Chartbusters. Well, this is a show where we'll highlight all the buzzing stocks. We also get your view on how do you trade the Nifty. I'm Nigel D'Souza, and with me, as always, Mangalam Malu. Hey, Mangalam.
Hi, Nigel. A tinge of pain in the air, perhaps, given the crude prices are higher and the mid-caps underperforming. Though individual stocks, they're doing well. The likes of Titan, that one's moved to the high point of the day ahead of results tomorrow. Had seen a bit of profit-taking, but currently, for the broader markets, we're at the low point of the day.
Yeah, that's right, Mangalam. You know, I'm just looking at one stock, HEG. We just had the management with us. They sounded very, very confident in terms of the outlook on graphite electrode prices. So that stock has moved to the high point of the day. But what's important to note is Graphite India as well. Remember, now the street will start factoring in that they as well will deliver a very good set of numbers. So after the strong commentary that's come in there, just take a look at Graphite India. That's moved to the high point of the day. HEG, as it is, had spiked up. Pull up the intraday chart of HEG. Remember, these stocks, they're nearly 10 baggers in the last 1 year. But after the positive commentary that's come in there, look at that. HEG is virtually at the high point of the day. Even Graphite India is moving higher. When you're talking about graphite electrode prices, in excess of around $10,000 on a per ton basis, clearly the street is excited. And even in fact, then the HEG management is saying that some parts of the world, it's even at $15,000 to $17,000 on a per ton basis, telling you that that EBITDA number can really expand. And that's what seems to be the case. And that's why the street is building these numbers in. HEG is now moved to the high point of the day, 6.5% after the massive run that we have seen just in the last 1 year. Both these two stocks, remember, they're the key India producers. They export a lot of their produce as well. So Graphite India and HEG clearly reacting to those statements that came in from the HEG management. Pull up Graphite India as well. I'll be waiting by for these set of numbers. Now, if that is, you know, if HEG has delivered such a good set, what can they deliver?
Absolutely. And it's interesting that you mentioned two stocks moving in tandem, because day before yesterday, we got Exide numbers. Oh. Exide margins were higher. And if you take a look at Amara Raja Batteries, that one's too moved post Exide numbers. They're believing that maybe if Exide can do it, why not Amara Raja?
Yeah. And Mangalam, talking about global players, you know, there was a graphite electrode player that came out a couple of days with their set of numbers, and they said the outlook is very, very strong. They were talking about $17,000 on a per ton basis. So they sounded confident, but the street was still skeptical. What is HEG going to say? And they have been positive, and that explains why both these two stocks are spiking up.
All right, so we'll keep an eye out on all these individual stocks. First up, all the top stories that we're tracking at this point in time. Top of mind, Brent crude prices. They surge above $76 per barrel. President Donald Trump withdraws out of the Iran nuclear accord. Oil marketing companies take the biggest hits in trade today.
And ID stocks get a boost as the rupee falls to its lowest levels versus the USD since February 2017.
Hindalco subsidiary Novelis delivers a strong fourth quarter performance and results. Brokerages positive on the stock.
And Jubilant FoodWorks gains after reporting good results yesterday. The management commentary in the earnings call was optimistic. Brokerages, they upped the target price.
In key results today, the street will be watching out for Eicher Motors, expected to deliver a strong performance in both Royal Enfield and commercial vehicle business, while JSPL, too, expected to report a net profit after losses for 13 consecutive quarters.
Okay, all right, we've got a bit of a dip actually on the Nifty. Let's find out whether or not that needs to be bought into. But before we do that, just pull up HEG Mangalam. We were talking about a 5-6% gain. Take a look at the stock. Now it's up 8.5%. You know, at the start of the interview that the HEG management was talking to us, the stock was at around 3,000 rupees. So from there, it's moved all the way to around 3,180. Just at the start of the show a few minutes ago, we were looking at it around 3,130-odd. Big, big volumes on that one as well. How do you trade the Nifty, though? Ashwini Gujral joins in. Ashwini, is there a trade on the Nifty? Will you be looking to buy this dip?
See, I would think so, because IT and banks both are looking fairly decent. So it's difficult to see what should take the Nifty lower. So that way, I think the best index to buy is probably CNX IT, then the bank Nifty, and then possibly the Nifty. Also, what's interesting is that, you know, mid-cap IT continues to perform. So the morning calls of NIT Tech, Tata Elxsi are moving. Now, you know, Jubilant has come back fairly strongly, like almost 2.5% from the lows. And it's almost cleaned out a lot of, you know, yesterday's weakness. I think yesterday's high was 26.60 thereabouts. I won't be surprised if Jubilant takes out yesterday's high and goes even higher, given the way Titan is performing. So my sense is, that's the kind of turnaround you want to buy. Similar turnaround in Maharaja batteries, you can see yesterday was a down day. A lot of stocks which had down days yesterday are now beginning to move up. And as we speak, Bank Nifty is almost, getting past yesterday's high. So that way, this market looks fairly strong and is firing on all cylinders. As far as calls right now are concerned, Balkrishna Industries are buy with a stop of 1240, target of 1275. Yes Bank is a buy with a stop of 344, target of 360. And Kotak is a buy with a stop of 1230, target of 1275. But Jubilant is something I would look for, because yesterday chances are a lot of shorts happened maybe, and those shorts could get covered as the day goes by.
All right, Ashwini, thanks a lot for that. Fair point that you make on the Nifty Bank. Axis Bank is the one which has moved to the high point of the day. Along with that, we have big boy HDFC Bank too, has taken the Nifty Bank into the green. But talking about banks, sources tell CNBC TV18 that lenders to the debt-ridden SR Steel yesterday voted to allow bids from both ArcelorMittal and New Metal on the condition that they repay dues to remain eligible. Ritu Singh joins in with more details. Ritu.
That's right, Mangalam. Yesterday in a voting that concluded, lenders have passed the resolution to allow from both New Metal and ArcelorMittal for SR Steel on the condition that they clear the dues that are pending for all the defaulting companies attached to the promoters of these two companies. So for ArcelorMittal, we understand, as we've been reporting, KSS Petron and Uttam Galva Steels is what they'll have to clear, which amounts to about 7,000 odd crore rupees. But for New Metal, the ask is much taller on account of Revanth Ruya being part of the consortium. Lenders have asked them to clear defaults of all SR group companies that have been defaulting. Those dues could run up to many, many thousands of crores. That exact figure we're yet to ascertain, but the debt of the SR group companies is over 1 lakh crore rupees. So a large part of that will have to be cleared for New Metal to remain eligible. While Arcelor has conveyed its intention to repay the dues, New Metal has asserted that it is not liable to repay dues of SR Group companies on account that it has offered to buy out Revanth Ruya's stake in the consortium, something that is not agreeable to the lenders because they're looking at the bids as they were originally submitted. We also understand that both of these players have been given 7 days starting today to get a no-all-clear certificate from the bankers, failing which they will not remain eligible. As of now, as we've reported, ArcelorMittal remains the highest bidder.
Thanks a lot for that. In fact, Ritu just said that ArcelorMittal has to clear Uttam Galva Steels and KSS Petron dues of close to around 7,000 crores. Uttam Galva is the listed one, Nigel. Anything to add on that? How do things change?
Uttam Galva, Mangalam, has been the big underperformer because of the big debt that they have in their books. I'll look at this very, very closely and I'll see whether or not Uttam Galva can suddenly come out of this sharp correction that we have seen and the poor performance that we have seen from Uttam Galva in the recent past. Remember, it's only around a 14 rupee stock. Now the market capitalization is only around 200 crores odd. But why are we looking at Uttam Galva? Because of that line where Ritu said that ArcelorMittal, they could clear all the dues of Uttam Galva. Now they're looking at nearly around 7,000 crores of clearing out.
Right.
Out of that, Uttam Galva, they're the listed entity that is, it has a debt of around 5,600 crores approximately. Okay. If you look at the financials in the past, the revenue has been around 3,500 crores approximately, but the finance cost is the reason why, in fact, they have delivered a loss of around 800 crores. So bulk of that loss is because of the finance cost. I'll tell you, not just that, Mangalam, they have a capacity of around 1 million tons approximately.
Right.
What they do is they take HRC, they convert it into CRC, and then they sell it back either to the person who has supplied them the HRC. Now, in the last 1 year, a lot of their customers, a lot of their clients, like a JSW Steel, they've stopped dealing with them because they're scared. If I give my HRC to Uttam Galva, and if in fact it gets into their NCLT trap, etc., then what if that doesn't come back and it gets stuck? So this really happens, this 5,500 crores getting cleared out of Uttam Galva's books. I'll watch Uttam Galva very closely because it could help the operational performance, and also it could make it virtually debt-free. In terms of a conversion charge, they get what, 3,000 to 4,000 rupees on a per ton basis at least. So we'll keep an eye out on this stock. It's only a 200 crore currently market cap, 14 rupees stock, but keep an eye out on this one. If this goes through, we'll have to watch out for the contours, but it's going to be very, very important because it can actually be a game changer if things go as per plan.
Absolutely. 5,600 of debt, 654 crores of EBITDA. That's virtually the entire net loss that the company makes. So we'll keep an eye out on that and whether Uttam Galwa does go ahead and become debt-free if those dues are paid. With green as of now, after dipping briefly into the red for the markets, the mid-caps too have recovered a bit. Consumption, that one stands out. Titan ahead of its numbers tomorrow. That one's at the high point of the day. Along with that, we have PVR. That one too has spiked. Remember, they reported their numbers on Monday, and 37% ad growth is something that the street fairly liked, and that one too has moved to the high point of the day. But let's just focus away from the secondary markets into the primary markets. Indostar Capital Finance IPO opens for subscription today. What does the company do? What exactly is it aiming to do going forward? And is the issue priced fairly? Abhishek is here with more details. Abhishek.
Well, Mangalam, it's an NBFC which is now trying to diversify itself into the retail segment of the NBFCs. So corporate portfolio, as you see, the share was at 99.8% in FY15. That has now reduced to about 77%. The issue opens on 9th of May and it closes on 11th of May. Price band is between 570 to 572. Equity offered is about 3.2 crore. So that makes the offer size at 1,844 crore with a market cap of close to 5,213 crore. Coming on to the valuations based on FY19 and FY20, the price to book value multiple is 1.6 and 1.5 times, which is, you know, cheaper than the listed peers right now. The strength of the company is the leverage is below 3x. What I mean by leverage is equity to assets. So that leverage is on the lower side, depicts the management's conservative approach as well as healthy capitalization. Company is trying to diversify its loan book. Over the last 2 to 3 years, we have seen SME portfolio growing, and now they are also focusing in vehicle finance and housing finance. And apart from that, the weakness is yields, which in a rising interest rate scenario, due to much of the portfolio borrowing coming in shorter duration, can hurt their margins going ahead. Back to you.
All right, Abhishek, thanks a lot for that. You're talking about yields which are rising currently. Going ahead, they can hurt their margins. In fact, we'll pose the same question to the management who's waiting by for us. R. Sridhar, the executive vice chairman and CEO of the company, joins us. Thanks a lot, Mr. Sridhar, for joining in. My colleague raised a concern with regards to the rising yields. So if you could tell us, what is the average duration of the loans that you give out vis-a-vis the average duration of the money that you borrow for? Because I'm looking at your borrowing mix, more than 50% is less than 1 year. So if you could put out those details for us.
No, the lending period for each vertical is different. And it's more or less on 3 to 5 years for corporate loans as well as vehicle loans. When it comes to SME and home loans, it's 10 to 15 years. But as you know, the SME and home loans, normally the repayment period is around 6 to 7 years. That's the tenure for which we lend to our customers. And as far as the ALM is concerned, in each bucket, we are positive. There is absolutely no gap in any bucket in the ALM. So we don't borrow short and lend long. That's pretty sure.
Mr. Sridhar, you know, you've given us your lending durations. You know, I didn't get the borrowing durations. If you could help us out with that number, because that's the mismatch that we're talking about. And also, I wanted to understand about your diversification plans going ahead. Bulk of your exposure now is to corporate loans. So going ahead, how do you see that mix changing?
Yeah, this company started in 2011 with predominantly corporate lending. Corporate lending, both real estate as well as non-real estate. Mm. And during the last 7 years, we have lent more than 25,000 crores. With the asset base as of now outstanding is 5,000 crores. So 20,000 crores has come back from the borrowers. And what is heartening is not even 1 rupee credit loss we have faced in the last 7 years. So the corporate lending book is not only profitable, but it is of high quality. So that is one hallmark of it. And the current plan is to take this company from the corporate lending, diversify into retail segments. The retail segment, already the company has started lending into SME from 2015, and we opened 10 branches. The assets under management is 1,500 crores in SME. We are financing small medium enterprises for their on the basis of their business cash flows, with the collateral of mostly self-occupied residential property, and this would be in only 10 centers. We have a license for doing home loans also. We have a subsidiary 100% held by this NBFC, which is going to focus into home loans, predominantly affordable home loans. So these come at around 12.5 to 13%, and we just started in December. Okay. But the main stay is going to be in the vehicle finance, mostly predominantly used vehicle financing, which would come at around 15 to 16% yield. That's the business which we were going to do in the retail. That would be the main engine.
Well, sir,
and we have already opened 100 branches.
Sir, the branches
have already started dispersing.
Right. You know, Mr. Sridhar, how are you going to penetrate that vehicle finance segment? There is already so much competition out there. Do you, you know, how will you grow your book?
See, vehicle financing is a very niche segment, and we are going to focus on used vehicle financing. Yes. In the used vehicle financing, the customer segment which we are going to focus is going to be two or three vehicle owners who are known as small fleet owners. And in this, few companies are there, but all of them are mainly focusing on new vehicles. Some used vehicles is there, and we are confident with the kind of experienced team which we have assembled. About 700 to 800 right. people have joined right. Indostar in the last year. And okay. this team has experience of lending to used vehicles in that segment. And we will be able to get good market share
right.
over the years.
Mr. Sridhar, we get it. And also, we understand that you're from Shriram Transport. Your erstwhile company is that. So we'll keep an eye out on how you grow that portfolio. With me is Abhishek. Abhishek, you have a question?
Well, Mr. Sridhar, you know, looking at your portfolio right now, 77% is in corporate portfolio and you are trying to diversify. Well, what I see in your numbers is that your disbursement to AUM growth, particularly in corporate loan portfolio, has declined from 23-25% level to about 13% level. So are you seeing faster repayments over there and therefore the growth to AUM is on the lower side while disbursement remains strong?
No, the disbursements are quite strong in the corporate lending. Around 3,500 to 4,000 crores we have been lending. And we also do a lot of downselling. There are a lot of prepayments. And particularly in the last year, you must notice that there is an introduction of RERA, GST, and demonetization. So we did go slow, but it dipped in the middle of the year. But at the end of the year, you will see that it has gone back to 5,000 crores. It's a temporary blip. And we strategically kept our disbursements low.
All right, Mr. Sridhar, before we let you go, one last question from my end. 31% is your capital ratio. In fact, your leverage just about 3 times. That's a little conservative. Do you think that is what will stay going forward, or you have a target to reduce it to a certain level?
No, today, you know, only corporate lending, one vertical is there, so the capital is more. And we are raising 700 crores now. That will take our capital requirement to about 3 years. We are very confident that our growth is going to be very fast in the retail segment. And we are, you know, beefing up our capital for meeting our growth requirements. So the capital will be comfortable, but it will not be at 31. It will come down going forward.
Ruchi Soya has heated up, as the screen is telling you. You have a whole host of offers that are coming there, and some of those bids, I think, that they are, we have a sense of what they've offered. Ritu Singh joins us to fill us in with all those details. Ritu. Ritu, if you could fill us in, who is the highest bidder? Okay, I think we don't have Ritu Mangalam, but you know, the important point to note for all our viewers out there is what is the equity value that's left. If there is a bid that's there, that's good.
Absolutely.
Use. Remember, they have a very high finance cost. And at one point of time, I mean, even now, the finance cost was more than the market
cap.
Over
the last 7 years, the finance cost has been higher than the market cap of the company. The debt was 5,600 crores.
Yeah.
And Ritu was suggesting that Patanjali is giving, what, 4,000 crores, Ritu? I think we have her with us.
That's right, Mangalam. We understand that the four bids that were received for Ruchi Soya have yesterday been opened by the lenders in the Committee of Creditors meeting that was held. So the four bids include Patanjali Ayurved, Godrej Agrovet, Imami Agrotech, as well as Adani Ulma, as you were mentioning. We understand that Patanjali is, in fact, the one that has made the highest offer, and that offer, in fact, comes with no conditions attached. In fact, lenders are surprised to hear even Patanjali Ayurved saying that they were willing to pay the full amount of 4,000 crore rupees in cash within the next 30 days if they were declared the winning bidder. We understand that the second highest offer has come from Adani Wilmar, which has placed a bid of about 3,200 crore rupees for Ruchi Soya. The other two bidders, that are Imami Agrotech and Godrej Agrovet, both of them have only bid for parts of the company, so that really won't be considered. So it's really Patanjali and Adani in the running, and it looks like Patanjali for now is the highest bidder. Of course, it has not been declared H1 yet. Do remember, Ruchi Soya has a debt of 12,000 crore rupees. We reached out to Patanjali as well. They said it was too premature to comment on the bid.
Absolutely, Ritu. Thanks a lot for that. The stock, while it has recovered from the low point of the day, remember, Ritu said the debt on their books is 12,000 crores. The offer is 4,000 crores. So does that mean that there is no equity value? That is a question we leave you on Chartbusters with. But stay tuned to CNBC TV18.